Being a bit about Halloween, now that the ghosts have come up their sheets and the zombies go wherever they go, I don't know, it's over for another year. But I've been reflecting on this holiday in our society and how it's changed over my lifetime. I remember as a child that it wasn't exciting holiday, obviously, you know, ask for candy. I always felt a little sorry for the teachers the next morning that had a classroom of kids that are on sugar high. You know, it wasn't that big a deal. It seems like as the years go by, the holiday of Halloween just gets bigger and bigger and bigger, with more displays in the stores, more parties, more decorations, more elaborate costumes. And I don't think that's necessarily wrong. I am interested in why that might be happening in our society. I'm not sure I know, but a couple things come to me. One is, people do seem to like to be scared. You know, they like to go to horror movies, they like haunted houses. I guess there's some kind of a rush that you get from being scared. So Halloween, of course, is one of those times when it's legitimate. There are other people. Be scared yourself, I guess. So that's maybe one thing. Secondly, I note that people really like, both adults and kids, to get dressed up in costumes and pretend they're somebody else for a while. And just try on a new persona. And actually, it's kind of fun because some of these costumes are very creative and it's just fun to see what people come up with. And I'm not being critical of that either. I think, after all, we pastor, we dress up every time we come to church, so I can't talk about people in costumes. I don't know if that's why Halloween has appealed to people, but it's interesting. And of course, you know, and it was already referred to in the children's talk, where Halloween comes from, or that term. Back in the 8th century, Pope Gregory IV decided that a lot of saints were not getting enough attention. There are a lot of saints that had their own Saints Day, St. Mary's Day, St. Paul's Day, St. John's Day, we know about those. But there are a lot of other saints that didn't have their own day. And he thought there ought to be a time when those people were remembered and celebrated. And of course, what he had in mind in the Roman Catholic Church at that time, saints were people who had done extraordinary things for the faith. Maybe even been martyred, and whenever they were depicted, they had a halo over their head. That's the kind of saint that was originally intended for this festival. And then November 2nd was called All Souls Day. That's when everybody else was remembered and celebrated. Well, that day was called All Hallows Day, or All Holy Ones Day, All Hallows, that's Old English. And of course, the night before it was the Eve of All Hallows, or All Hallows Eve, and over time that it became corrupted. Instead of All Hallows Eve, people said it turned into Halloween, and that's part of the term, probably. When the Reformation came along, we Protestants read the Bible and realized that when the Bible talks, and the New Testament talks about saints, it's not just people who have done special things and have halos on their heads, but it's every Christian is considered a saint because we're saints not by the merit that we earn, good things we do, but because of what Christ did for us. And that makes every single one of us saints, saints and sinners at the same time, but we're all saints. And that's what we celebrate today, all the saints, all who have gone before us. And remember that we are a part of all the saints. Now, I thought it would be appropriate to think of three things today. Our predecessors, our promises, and our possibilities. So I want to talk just a little bit about each of those. First of all, our predecessors. A lot of times we don't think about it, but we are so indebted to those who have come before us for virtually everything in our lives. And that's true in the secular world as well. When you think about what has been built up in this country, that makes it possible for us to do what we do, from roads to electrical grids to just the whole system that's been put together to that we can build on. We can really stand on the shoulders of countless people that have gone before us. I think it's really important to remember that we also have the freedoms that we have in this country, the safety and security we have because of a lot of people who gave their lives in the service of this country to make what we have possible. So we stand on their shoulders too, but we're very much indebted to them. We hope we never forget them. But there's also people in our families that have built up the family and nourished us, and our foundations are very much built on what they give us, whether it's parents, grandparents, great-grandparents. You can go way back, I'm sure, a lot of you, and see the foundation that you built so you can be where you are today. You remember those people. But especially when we think about people in the church, people that are saints in the faith, who preserve the faith for us, who pass it on to us, who've done some incredible things to keep the faith alive during some dicey times in human history. Ruth and I were just 2 weeks ago in Istanbul, in Turkey. And as you probably know, that used to be a Christian city. It's called Constantinople. Well, the Turks came along in the 1400s and finally overran that city and turned the beautiful cathedral Hagia Sophia, that's been there since 500, into a mosque. You probably know about this, but one of the things that I was reminded of is the Turks kept going to the west, and they were at the gates of Vienna at one time. And had it not been for a few critical battles where Christians gave their lives and took a stand, it could very well have been that Europe would have become Muslim as well. So we're grateful for the saints who have fought for the faith. I often think, too, about the very early Christians. You know, as Christianity started out, it was very small. In fact, some scholars describe it as a Jewish sect, a messianic sect. The only thing different from those early Christians and Jews was these particular Jews happened to believe that the Messiah had come. Otherwise, they were very much the same. There was some danger that it would never get more than that. But something happened. One scholar in particular believes that one of the reasons that the Christian church grew was because of early Christians' compassion for others. You see, in late antiquity, the towns or cities of that time were not built very well. They were kind of a hodgepodge, and poor people or middle-class people tended to live in very small apartments, kind of clustered around the big buildings of the city, and that's true in Antioch, Alexandria, Jerusalem, Rome, any of those places. And because of that, it was not unusual for every few years a major catastrophe to come to all those cities, and it did regularly. Sometimes it was a fire, because everybody was cooking with charcoal or wood, and in those little apartments, it wasn't unusual for there to be a fire that spread and destroyed much of the town, the city. The rich people would leave. People needs, and also the doctors. There are other things that happen too, because they were so close. Plagues would come, disease, and it would spread very quickly and wipe out people, and again, rich people would leave. And the third thing that was a real danger to these towns were conquering armies. They were just one army after another would come through, and if your defenses weren't strong, it could be destroyed. And so that was happening over and over again. And typically the rich people would leave, the guests would stay and take care of people, the Christians. They stayed and took care of the wounded folks, the orphan, the widow, people who needed help. They had compassion. And the people who received this compassion took note. In fact, they said, now this is worth something. It was much more meaningful than those Roman and Greek gods, Apollo and Aphrodite and all of those people. And suddenly they began to see something with some depth. These Christians had compassion and they wanted to be a part of it. And that, according to many scholars, is why the church grew to what it has become. I am also grateful for more modern-day saints. And in fact, just as you were talking about the raising money and this, what this congregation does in this valley, I know this, what I'll bring this forward, you said, this hand is an elsewhere, that the vision for this chapel, I remember, I was with Bruce Moncrief 20-some years ago, he was really the one who came up with the thing that said, we really ought to get going on this. We called it Project 2020, because we thought it would take the 2020 to do this. But thanks to St. Bruce and his pushing and getting us all together, look at what we have today, and your congregation has been huge. Steve, Father Brooks, have all really been the leadership behind it, so I'm grateful for those things as well. So we're thankful for our predecessors, and I know that each one of us has people that we are especially grateful for, maybe our parents or some other person that's nurtured us, mentored us in the faith. And we give thanks to those, including those whose names we read today. Our predecessors. Secondly, our promises. Many of the lessons today mention the promises that are in store for us as God's saints. One of the promises that comes through very clearly is there won't be any more suffering. You will be with God. That's very clear in the lessons today. And actually, we aren't told real details about what that's going to be. We just are told it's going to be really good, and you can trust that. Sometimes it's painted as a garden, you know, with ever-flowing streams and trees that always give fruit. But sometimes it's a banquet in the presence of God, and a wonderful banquet. And sometimes it's a city with paved streets, jeweled gates and so on. Many different pictures of this, but I think they all fall short. I think it's really beyond what we can possibly imagine. We have our promises. And thirdly, we have our possibilities. If I were to ask any of you, or all of us, I would ask all of you to describe yourself to another. I bet that you would do a pretty good job of telling them about what you do, and what your hobbies are, and your families, where you live, all that. But I bet you hardly any of you would say, by the way, I'm a saint. We don't see ourselves as saints, and we know we're not. I mean, saint does not mean being perfect. It doesn't even mean being extraordinary. You're a saint simply as a Christian, the first times. But what's happened is we don't see ourselves as God's saints. I think it's a little bit of a kind of identity theft. Not that anybody else has taken it away from us. We just don't give it to ourselves. We forget that we're saints. We are the boots on the ground right now. You know, the theologians talk about the church militant. That's the people that are doing the work right now. Future generations will look back on, hopefully with thanks. And then there's the church triumphant, the ones that have made it. But we're the ones, we're the saints in the trenches today. And it would be good if we could remember that we're the saints. And a lot of times, we let the world tell us who we are. And we need to remember. Nothing they think about us changes. So I want to tell you a story that some of my friends here have heard me tell before. But I don't apologize for telling it again because it's one that I need to hear over and over again. It's about a man who was a great and wise teacher, and he had followers. And one day he was walking along a river that was swollen with runoff. It was a really good river. And this particular teacher had great compassion for all living things. It's just one of the things about him. As they walked along, he noticed that there was a tree that had fallen across the water. And the branches were sticking up, and the branches, you know how they vibrate when the water's running through them. And he noticed that on one of the branches, there was a scorpion that was barely hanging on. It was going to be knocked off into the water drowned. And this man stepped into the water, pretty rough current, and very carefully went over, and he went and flipped the scorpion onto the log so that it would be safer, not a danger. And process, the scorpion stung his hand. It hurt. And he was on his way back to the bank, making his way slowly, and looked over his shoulder and he noticed that the scorpion, because the water just kept coming up in his bags, was in danger again. So this guy turns around and goes out into this really strong current. He could have lost his footing easily if it swept away. But he once again reaches out and flips that scorpion up a little further, so it's a little safer, and it's stung again. And by this time, his hand is turning red, starting to swell, obviously painful. But he makes his way back to the bank. Sure enough, he looks back, the scorpion is in trouble again. Half the scorpion. And so he wades way out into the water. Water's really strong right now, but he actually picks up the scorpion and carries it over to the bank. And the whole time he's got it in his hand, it's stinging him. Multiple times. And his hand is just swollen, red, and big, painful. And he comes up out of the water and stands on the bank, and his followers are looking at him. What did you do? And finally, one of them had the courage to say, "Master, why did you do that for that vile creature?" And he said, "Just because it is the nature of a scorpion to sting does not change my nature to have compassion." I love that story because I think it describes Jesus Christ, for one thing. You think about how people try to discredit him and pull him down his enemies. He didn't return evil for evil. He went to the cross for us. And I need to remember that my nature as a saint is not determined by what other people do to me. Even though other people may sting, that does not change my nature to have compassion. That's what it means to be a saint. So three things. Remember our predecessors today. We give thanks for all the saints who've gone before us, the ones that shoulders we stand on, and who have given us so much. We remember the promises that are all through Scripture for the saints, for you and me, beyond our expectation. We can just tuck that away and be absolutely confident. And thirdly, we can remember our possibilities, because we are the saints that are called upon to produce now. And to remember that regardless of what others do, it is our nature to have